It's Monday. This is 10's late news with all the news you need. Tonight, terror threat raised. The nation's spy chief warns of new hybrid ideologies and online radicalisation. Misinformation fuelled rage, rioting in multiple UK cities fuelled by hate and fear. $100 billion wiped from our stock market in a single day. What's causing the global sell-off? Source found health authorities pinpoint the cause of Melbourne's deadly Legionnaires outbreak. New tonight, a PM flees the country after weeks of unrest, sparking celebrations on the streets of Bangladesh. 18 months later, and a Kiwi pilot being held hostage by a rebel group in Indonesia could soon be released. Thousands more Aussies marched back to the office, so is your cushy home setup at risk? Growing concern over an explosion of people buying fake weight loss medication as a new and approved drug hits Aussie shelves. One hell of a whale tale, or lack thereof, how this creature keeps on swimming. And the race that kickstarts a nation. Strap in, it's going to be a wild ride.
Welcome to 10's Late News with Ursula Hayden.
First tonight, more Australians are being radicalised and are willing to use violence to advance their cause. That's the warning as our PM and the domestic spy chief raise the terror threat level to probable for the first time in 2 years. The increased warning puts the likelihood of an attack at more than 50% within the next 12 months. Security agencies say the COVID-19 pandemic increased anti-authority beliefs, which have been exacerbated by the October 7th attacks in Israel and its subsequent war in Gaza. The fear is, with that will come a rise in politically motivated violence, including terrorism, with attacks likely to occur with little or no warning. And the perpetrators are most likely to be young. Recent cases saw suspects aged between 14 and 21 years old.
Individuals are moving to violence with little or no warning and little or no planning. Acts of violence can be almost spontaneous or purely reactive.
But there is no current intelligence about an imminent attack. Let's go to our network political editor, Ashley Raper. And Ash, they're worried about homegrown lone wolf attacks in particular.
Yes, Ursula. And since April, there have been 8 alleged terrorism attacks or incidents, or ones that have been investigated as potential terrorism, that fit that definition. Now, the ASIO boss has been clear today that the current situation is different. Last time the terrorism threat level was raised was back in 2014, and that was in response to the emergence of Islamic State. Right now, there's not one extremist ideology that can be tracked. People, and so far it's been young men, are blending ideologies to suit a perceived injustice or a personal narrative when they feel aggrieved. And ASIO says that's creating the threat of lone wolf attacks that aren't sophisticated or heavily planned. It's a lone actor with a knife or a gun. And they're also responding to the current climate where there is online self-righteousness.
The alleged perpetrators appear to be motivated by extreme religious beliefs, in others, nationalist and racist beliefs. These factors make ASIO's job more difficult. The threats are becoming harder to predict and identify. The drivers of radicalisation, grievance, extremism are growing and interacting in ways we've not seen before.
But we know that social media is playing a role in this. One of the things about social media is that the algorithms push people towards more extremes and they reinforce views.
The Prime Minister there, and he pointed out that the eSafety Commissioner does have the power to remove extremist content from online. But of course, we've seen that some tech giants are more compliant in this space than others. There's also talk about age limits and age assurance technology on social media, and there's also a review happening of the Online Safety Act. So There is perhaps more to do in response to this and more to come, Ursula.
Thank you. Ashley Raper there. That online misinformation is being blamed for widespread rioting and clashes with the police in the UK. Hate, anger and outrage is driving clicks, and the social media algorithm is amplifying that content. It began in Southport, a seaside town north of Liverpool. Three young girls were killed in a mass stabbing attack on a Taylor Swift-themed dance party, provoking horror and distress. But what followed lit a fuse. There were incorrect reports the stabber was a Muslim immigrant who arrived via boat. He's actually a 17-year-old from Cardiff in Wales. Within hours, it had sparked riots in Southport with more than 50 police officers injured. What has now followed is fighting and disorder in major city after major city. Sunderland, Belfast, Manchester, Liverpool, Leeds and Nottingham, among others. Hotels housing asylum seekers have been firebombed. More than 150 people have been arrested and police have linked it to local neo-Nazi groups. This is nothing new. Propaganda works, and its use in serving an ideology is well known. The issue now is it's spreading faster than the truth, served directly to people's social media, whether they're looking for it or not. So where does the blame lie, and what can be done?
There is certainly a history of race riots in the UK that existed long before social media came into play, but I think we're seeing social media increasingly used as an organising tool. In the UK, there has been a long discussion about introducing some sort of online safety act, and that is probably likely to come into play now. But as we saw in Australia with X taking the e-safety commissioner to the federal court around the streaming the stabbing of the Christian cleric, they can argue that national bodies don't have reach outside a particular domain. So it's very tricky legal territory.
There's no doubt there is significant unease in the UK surrounding immigration. We saw that with Brexit and with the recent limited success of the Reform Party led by Nigel Farage, an anti-immigration politician who questioned the identity of the teenager allegedly behind the Southport murders. But now the spotlight should also be on big tech and how their platforms are helping to inflame an already dangerous situation. Back home now, and the Australian share market has suffered its worst day since the start of the pandemic, losing more than 100 billion Australian dollars in value. The stock sell-off is sweeping the globe, triggered by fears of a US recession. All eyes now on Wall Street as America wakes up.
Monday on the ASX, still nursing a hangover from Friday. The last two trading days, erasing an estimated $160 billion from local stocks.
It's often the case when share markets move, they go up via the staircase and down via the elevator. So the moves are quite quick and violent. You get those billions wiped off very quickly.
Billions wiped from markets around the world. Japan's Nikkei recording one of its worst days in history. This economist saying, I think there is a sense of selling stocks in panic. It comes after an interest rate cut in the US was interpreted by investors as the rumblings of a recession. High unemployment figures from Friday adding fuel to those fears.
The old saying is, when they catch a cold, the rest of us get the flu.
For Australia to resist the contagion.
And I think it would be totally foolish to consider another interest rate hike here. I think the Reserve Bank should be actually starting to give consideration about when they will start to cut interest rates.
While the world is watching Wall Street's next move, Aussies await their interest rate announcement tomorrow. Paris Martin for 10 News First.
A man has been shot by police in Toowoomba after allegedly making threats and producing a knife during a confrontation with officers. Police were called to the home for a welfare check and say the man was known to them. He has been taken to Toowoomba Hospital with life-threatening injuries. Two police officers are also being treated for minor injuries. Victorian health officials are confident they have located the source of Melbourne's Legionnaire's disease that has already killed two people. After testing more than 50 locations across the city, the Department of Health revealed a cooling tower in Leverton North tested positive for the disease.
The tower was visited early in our investigation on July the 30th and was disinfected within 24 hours of that visit. This is a direct result of our rapid investigation, which saw the likely source located, tested, disinfected within a matter of days.
There are currently 77 confirmed cases. Linda Reynolds has taken the stand on the second day of her defamation trial against former staffer Brittany Higgins. The senator revealed she was gobsmacked when she was told Ms. Higgins and Bruce Lerman had accessed her ministerial office.
Delighted to take the stand in her defamation trial against former staffer Brittany Higgins.
I'm delighted to be able to finally, after 3.5 years, tell the truth.
This afternoon, Senator Linda Reynolds revealed there hadn't been an allegation of rape made when she chose to meet with Brittany Higgins in her ministerial office in 2019. The former defence minister said Ms. Higgins appeared upset and she urged her to think about talking to the AFP and reach out to counselling services. She also said Ms. Higgins thanked her when the meeting ended. I think she was grateful she was keeping her job because other ministers would have sacked them both. She deserved a second chance. Brittany Higgins' defence lawyer Rachel Young opened the second day of the trial, saying the former defence minister must have known about claims Ms. Higgins was raped on a lounge in her office, as she had a mountain of information before she called the then staffer into a meeting. Ms. Young said suggestions from Senator Reynolds' defamation lawyer Martin Bennett that Ms. Higgins' views were a fairy tale were misplaced, harassing and re-traumatising, accusing him of not focusing on the three social media posts at the centre of the case, and told Justice Paul Tottle it's not worth the candle of a 5-week defamation trial. Amelia Simpson for 10 News First.
The bigger than pint-sized increase to the price of alcohol. Plus why thousands more workers are being marched back to the office. And a bizarre confession by an independent US presidential candidate. Australia now has the world's third highest alcohol tax after Finland and Norway, and that's thanks to an increase in the excise on beer and spirits today. Alcohol excise represents between 14 to 37% of the price paid for wine and beer, with half of the price of spirits. It goes up twice a year based on the movement of the Consumer Price Index. So does it pass the pub test? I highly doubt it. The era of working from home has come to a screeching halt for New South Wales public servants. In an Australian first, they've been ordered back to the office 5 days a week. And while not everyone will like it, city businesses hope it'll bring customers back through the door.
Well, New South Wales has the largest public service workforce in the country, and now all of them are being forced to return to the office full time. In an email circulated from the New South Wales Premier's department this afternoon, it read, "The more our experience of work is shared, the more united we become. And that means being physically present in our organisations." And so just like that, our time working from home appears to have come to an end. Public service workers in other states are still allowed flexible working arrangements, many of whom choose to work from home. Now, it's unclear at this stage if any other states will follow New South Wales and make these kinds of orders for their public service workers. One sector set to benefit, though, is, of course, cafes, retail, all of those hospitality and retail businesses in the CBD that will now see plenty of increased foot traffic as a result of this decision. No doubt we'll see plenty of people back on public transport too. It remains to be seen if we'll need to have any extra services in place to support all of these workers as they come back to the office.
Thank you, Taylor. Well, Ukraine has received its long-awaited US-made F-16 fighter jets, with President Zelensky thanking his Western allies. Releasing the first vision of the jets on display, Zelensky said they will strengthen the country's air defences against Russia. Before now, Ukraine has had to rely on an ageing fleet of Soviet-era warplanes. An independent US presidential candidate has made a bizarre confession. Robert F. Kennedy Jr. has admitted to being one of the culprits who dumped a dead bear cub in Central Park a decade ago. His motivation for sharing likely to get ahead of an upcoming bad headline. A group of rebels holding a New Zealand pilot hostage in Indonesia's Papua region are reportedly planning to release him. The former Jetstar pilot was captured 18 months ago while on an evacuation mission. The 38-year-old father was ambushed by armed rebels. His light plane was also set on fire. He was able to record a video for his wife last December.
I'm okay. They're treating me well. I'm trying to stay positive. And I hope that you and Jacob are healthy and doing okay and getting support.
His captors previously said they would only release him in exchange for independence for Papua. Well, how's this for a whale of a tale, or lack thereof? Whale watchers have spotted a humpback swimming off the US coast without one. Experts say it likely lost its 5-metre-wide tail after becoming entangled in some kind of fishing line.
This whale, swimming in the Salish Sea completely without a tail, I feel like is the poster child for the hazards that they're facing in the world's ocean.
Research shows most humpbacks experience entanglement during their lives, but they often aren't able to escape it. Well, up next on 10's Late News, growing concerns over the explosion of fake weight loss drugs. And Mother Nature puts on a spectacular show is what lies believe. Beneath, blasts into the sky. Welcome back. An alternative to weight loss drug Ozempic is hitting Australian shelves this week, hoping to ease shortage pressures on the popular diabetes medication. The new brand's arrival comes amid a spike in the sale of fake weight loss medications overseas.
It's the weight loss drug everyone wants to get their hands on. Now, a new version is hitting Australian shelves.
Wegovy is a new obesity agent available in Australia. It is essentially the same drug as Ozempic, but at a higher dose.
The release comes at an opportune time after a concerning spike in the online sale of fake Ozempic in the UK.
It's not surprising that people are opportunistic and are selling these agents online. And you don't really know what you're getting necessarily if you're buying online as well. And I think that you can obviously be ripped off by people selling fake Ozempic or Ozempic that's watered down.
The hope is Wegovy will reduce demand on Ozempic and help those who really need it.
We treat obesity as a chronic disease and we treat it aggressively because it has consequences. And so I'm very much in favour of these drugs that are highly effective in reducing weight loss.
Jack Perry for 10 News First.
There have been spectacular sights in Sicily with this lava display. Standing at more than 3,300 metres high, explosions at Mount Etna have intensified, although spare a thought for nearby towns now covered in a blanket of ash. Parts of the US are battening down the hatches as a hurricane barrels towards Florida. Here's Josh Holt.
Good evening. The name Debbie when referring to tropical weather systems probably sends a shiver down the spines of some Aussies, myself included. I was there 7 years ago when we experienced one of the strongest tropical cyclones to cross the Queensland coast, coming in just near the township of Bowen. Now another Debbie has caused chaos as it moved through the Gulf of Mexico towards Florida. You can see here it started out as some fun and games in the wind and rain as a tropical storm, but it has intensified now into a full-fledged hurricane. It is now expected to unload potentially historic amounts of rainfall when it slams into parts of Florida's Gulf Coast in a matter of hours. The National Hurricane Center is predicting potentially dangerous storm surges, some of which we have already been experiencing through parts of the West Coast. It's one we'll keep an eye on. Meanwhile, here at home, we're expecting a shower or two for Brisbane, most likely tomorrow night, an early shower for Sydney in 18, partly cloudy for Melbourne and Adelaide, a shower or two for Perth hitting 21.
Thanks, Josh. Well, finally tonight, if you think the Running of the Bulls festival is unique, hold on to your buffaloes. Thailand has kick-started its rice cultivation season with a water buffalo race. It has kept up the tradition as a reminder of the historic role of buffalo ploughing in agriculture. Locals say plenty of good grass and training is the secret to a winner. A high-stakes race indeed. Well, that's all the news you need this Monday, the 5th of August. I'm Ursula Hager. Thank you so much for joining us on 10's Late News. We hope you have a great night.